I know I'm irresistible, but my head is not a bat landing zone.
It's a Dashmore, please, thing. And could you bring some more glasses for the Joker meeting later? Thank you. Where's that spellbook, Grandmama?
Looks to me like you and Grandma Foxy are Ouija racing. Morticia, these rare books you found on pentagrams and potions are fabulous. But your favorite spell book seems to have vanished. What a surprise. No doubt it'll materialize before classes start. Spock was absolutely correct. Extraterrestrials are logical. The afterworld makes no sense whatsoever. Maybe there's a collective consciousness after all. Would that explain past life regression stories, possession, reincarnation, to have a physical effect in this dimension without taking form or displaying energy fields? It's most fascinating. I must research the ancient telekinesis manuscripts and how this is done. Did you notice that our new Ring doorbell facial recognition app is now identifying our ghostly ancestors and deceased relatives?
She said it's with the delinquent library books in the research room. Thank you, Grandmama.
Yes. One of the most unique paranormal abilities is telepathy. The aliens can read our innermost thoughts. As President Eisenhower found out, the voices you hear but no one else does are real. That was the beginning of our ET collaboration. And for all intents and purposes, is cloaked in secrecy, like the veil of darkness in the afterlife. For everything you see is an illusion.
A number of books on Eisenhower's alien meeting have been written. Mr. Sella is one of those authors whose hypothesis cannot be discounted. I will provide my summary shortly. Aliens, I understand. During World War II, the term Foo Fighter was coined to describe our UFO visitors. They would intermingle, dart around, tail end, simply put, dog both Allied and Axis squadrons. They were documenting and filming human folly, no doubt in disbelief and disappointment. The war ended, the nuclear age began, and a craft capable of reaching space was within reach. But there's a twist. America was basically unscathed. It did not start the war, but was instrumental in the defeat of those who did. Yet America, in spite of its losses and Soviet objections, began the Berlin airlift and assisted in the rebuilding of Japan. Our alien neighbor observed everything. This may have been a pleasant surprise. There is hope for humanity after all the carnage. From July 12th to July 29th, the aliens darted around Washington, D.C. For 17 days, they intermittently hovered over and around the White House, causing constant chaos. They were setting the stage for a meeting with Eisenhower. They wanted Eisenhower to know that Earth's technology was a bit primitive, as they toyed with Air Force jets and could come and go as they pleased. Knowing they have radar and visual cloaking abilities, this was purposely done. Generally speaking, unless there's an implant, aliens must be in close proximity to the subject for telepathic communication. I suppose being directly above the White House would be close enough. After a few days of hearing voices, Eisenhower probably acknowledged the invitation to discuss the world's future. No doubt he was thinking, I've gone nuts, only to find out he had not. The first meeting was probably at the White House. Aliens are adept at short-term memory brain looping. Those in the immediate area would be oblivious to the surrounding world, like a trance. The ship would be cloaked, and an emissary would beam down, or they would land. Eisenhower must have impressed them as an honest, sincere, straight-shooting leader who never wanted war or revenge. What the future may hold never feared him. Future meetings at Air Force bases would probably be ideal. The Greys mentioned are not Martian and are not from this solar system. But for some reason, the Greys seem to crash more often than any other alien race. Perhaps those long journeys behind the wheel can make you drowsy. General Raymond is the U.S. Space Force General. He is in charge of human and all other organic life forms assigned to him. We could theorize that our alien colleagues are like UN observers with valuable input when permitted. Since the extraterrestrials are assigned to us, then Gary McKinnon is probably correct. It is our spaceship paid for with black ops slush fund money. Elon Musk is probably correct. The U.S. debt is closer to $60 trillion. Mr. Sala brings up the topic of abductions. However, millions may be a bit overstated unless we are going back 25,000 years. I cannot begin to guess what they do with all the cattle. They must have incredible barbecues if they are not left as cattle mutilations. Humans, if returned after abductions, are usually alive and well. The one documented murder will be provided later in the video. Mr. Sala and others mention the alien aversion to nuclear testing, if not warheads altogether. These tests impact our planet. If so, that would indicate travel via a wormhole, portal, or vortex. This means they are compressing time and space. What goes in apparently goes out at their end. Hundreds of nuclear surface explosions were being conducted during this period. Bad timing on your choice of days to visit the Earth could be catastrophic. Extraterrestrials are mortal too. They, like most biological life forms, fear and feel pain and can die. The point at which revival is possible is only known to them. They are unable to revive humans who have truly deceased. Accounts of brain dead awakening are not uncommon, but at some point there is no return unless you alter history and in turn the future. Organic life forms do have their foibles, but they are easy to produce. Robots require more work, require different specifications depending upon the environment and a dedicated manufacturing facility area on board the ship. The Cube mothership is large enough for a factory, but most motherships are too small for massive plants. Aliens have the basic DNA blueprints for life forms throughout the galaxy. These can be easily modified to adapt to most planetary conditions. No major onboard factories are needed. The ivory soap bubbler does it all, a bit more advanced than our present cloning process. Alien-created life forms are reasonably well taken care of, but are considered expendable. After filming World War I, World War II, Korea, Vietnam, Afghanistan, Iraq, humans appear to be expendable as well. While broaching the subject of alien-created life forms, one in particular is occasionally seen and at first thought to be a Sasquatch until they realize it is a large, swift creature with red skin. This is one of the helpers, a tall entity with reddish skin. Telepathic capabilities can leap tall fences and is very, very swift. A large upper torso and back have been mentioned. In one document report, it telepathically communicated with a fast-approaching driver as it dashed across the road. It said, "Don't hurt," and continued on. This helper belongs to the aliens who have the triangles. These aliens are of small stature. The helpers are no doubt invaluable for their physical abilities. They can also breathe Earth's atmosphere, another added bonus. Many extraterrestrials seem to possess telepathic capabilities either naturally or through Elon Musk's implants. Just kidding. The reasons are obvious. Almost every human has spoken to someone with a different accent due to regional differences. If we compound this with someone who is learning your language, or vice versa, it can be very difficult to understand what they are saying. Different species have different vocal cords, if any at all. Each alien species is different, and the speech patterns and sounds could be inaudible or unintelligible to another species, even annoying. It would be prudent to start honing your telepathic abilities right now. Not to bore you with trivial minutiae and theories, let's look at some tangible facts regarding our spacecraft, which do not exist. First, a brief summary of military mindset must be acknowledged. Until more recently, the following documents outline military operating procedure with respect to press and witnesses involving alien craft, or ours. This has always been the rule of thumb. You can stop the video at any time to read the documents at your leisure. We shall quickly peruse the following documents. In brief, this recovery operations document basically outlines crash site preservation procedures, prevent removal, deny everything and the existence of UFOs, provide a cover story, discredit witnesses, and detain and interrogate any witnesses who may have seen anything. Today's social media sites carefully scrutinize your comments and videos. Having thoroughly tested the social media censor buttons, I find Rumble to be the most lenient, with a B+ to A-. YouTube is also fairly lenient, but as you can see, will not hesitate to remove a video concerning government documents which do not further the desired narrative. But YouTube still gets a B. Spotify, Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook get a strong C. The U.S. government gets a D-, and China's CCP an F. Fortunately, you are at my website, which gets an A+ for disclosure. These are wonderful free platforms, and they can do as they please. To summarize these documents, Lockheed, Boeing, Northrop, Teledyne, Ryan are the main TR-3B contracting firms, and the program is managed by the NRO, NSA, and CIA. The first prototypes were flown in the 1970s. The 250-foot model was launched prior to 1994. Three were operational. With respect to question number 4, they are kept at various military and secret manufacturing locations. They also have been seen on aircraft carriers, in space, and on the moon. The patent clearly states its use as an underwater craft. It could be anywhere. Frequently asked question number 6 concerns weapons. I believe it has 3 internal compartments housing 1 small tactical warhead in each compartment. These are deployed by a rapid spring launch mechanism. There is no heat signature, detectable plume, nor noteworthy radar signature. It is invisible and heading towards its detonation point at about 300 miles an hour. Many of us have seen the particle blaster used in the Middle East, a most formidable weapon indeed. Number 9 covers the navigation systems, but 10 answers another important question. The TR-3B has multi-mode propulsion engines at the tips and vectored thrusters on the edges. These billion-dollar babies are constructed from composites and titanium, and they have 2 points of access. The exterior chromatic coating can be electronically altered to change color and perception or blend with background. Landing gear consists of 3 retracting pods with T-pads. The TR-3B emits a perceptible and a bit of a static electricity charge. There are lights on the tips and center bottom. Small nuclear reactors are provided for field operation. The field negates sonic booms as well and reduces the gravitational attraction by 89%, resulting in atmospheric speeds up to Mach 9 or 6,750 miles per hour. Minimum Earth to lunar orbit velocity is 25,700 and solar escape is 36,500. In view of the propulsion drives, 50,000 miles per hour would be a surprise. Optimistically speaking, the moon would still be no less than a 5-hour flight. Mars would be at least 680 hours away, a 28-plus day trip. At 600 feet in diameter, the triangle is 155,885 square feet, over 2.7 times the size of a football field, and probably has multiple decks. No doubt crew complement has changed. The MFT magnetic field disruptor spins the mercury plasma at 50,000 RPM in a 150 degree Kelvin atmosphere in a vessel pressurized at 250,000 times atmosphere. The field basically interferes with Earth's magnetic field, the strong force, thus eliminating 89% of the craft's weight. The field effects are understandable, but the pressurized vessel running at 3,675,000 psi at 250,000 atmosphere, if one atmosphere is 14.7 psi, is incredible. Even if reduced by 89%, it would be over 404,000 psi. How is this possible? This original type PDF is difficult to read, but Edgar Fauch, who passed away in 2017, was one of the first to publicly discuss the TR-3B. Russia has certainly proven the use and value of rocket engines underwater, so a TR-3B submarine is quite possible. We will end the TR-3B discussion with a most apropos article. One who believes that the Edgar Fauch has merit, Jung Koyman, expands on details presented in Fauci's PDF. I will post a brief excerpt here. The full article can be found at rinse.com